good to be in the house of the Lord. Yes. It's always good to remember that God is good. You know, sometimes that we look at circumstances and think, you know, where is God? He's in the same space. You know, he doesn't move. The one thing about it, God still has got the world in his hand. You know, in Lamentations chapter 3, I'm going to start verse 21. Like I say, I love your smartphone, and you got different versions of the Bible. Lamentations 3:21, couple version, New International Version says, "Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope." I go to the next verse. Says, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail." Hallelujah. And another version, New American Standard, "The Lord's loving kindness indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail." And I love the International Standard Version because it says, "Because of the Lord's gracious love, we are not consumed, since his compassions never end." Mm-hmm. And God's Word Translation, "The Lord's mercy, we are not completely wiped out. His compassion is never limited." Now, we can think about that. You know, we think about the election, and I know there's a lot of emotion in all of this. But the one thing about it, God is still God.
Yes.
And what we do, and the Bible talks about it, that we pray for those in leadership. We might not agree, but we're going to pray for them. You know, because one thing about it is that God sees what's going on.
Yes.
God's aware of what's going on. Mm-hmm. And it's all about men's hearts. Think about what God has done for you today. I still think it's always better to start proclaiming rather than complain about everything. And lift up those. And when we talk about prayer, I always think about how that when the Israelites was coming out of Egypt and they was being pursued, and this was in Exodus 14, you know, I always think about that scene because they come up to the Red Sea and it looked like an impossible situation. Because you saw the dust of the Egyptians and all the chariots coming out after them, and the Red Sea is before them, and it looked like there is no way. But as I grew up, you know, they always say God makes a way out of no way. And Jesus himself said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So there's always a way. People always say, "Which way should I go?" The best way to go is follow Jesus. You can never go wrong following the Lord. That's what Paul said. All these things that happened to me for the furtherance of the gospel. Think about where you were a year back in the Lord. We should be a year farther. Every year we go in Christ, we should be more dedicated to him. You know, when we think about the Egyptians was coming, they was crying out to Moses. And I love what Moses told the people, because God, you know, he's crying out to God because, you know, all these people are on him. What are we supposed to do? You should have left us into Egypt. And that's what people have a tendency to do. When things are pressuring, they want to go back. But you know what God says? Go forward. That's what I love about God. He's a forward God. He's a present God. And look, he said, you know, they said in verse 12, this is Exodus 14, "Did we not tell you in Egypt, let us alone, let us serve the Egyptians, for it better for us to serve the Egyptians than die in the wilderness?" But look what Moses said. Moses told the people, "Fear not, stand still." This is the Amplified Version. "Stand still, firm, confident, undismayed, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today." Yeah. "For the Egyptians you have seen today, you shall never see again." Hallelujah. "The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace and remain at rest. The Lord said to Moses, 'Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward.'" That's what God speaks to you in those difficult situations, to go forward, not to back up. We're not supposed to have reverse gear. We're supposed to go forward. And he said, the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of the Lord to go forward. Lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea." Hallelujah. "And I behold, I will harden, make stubborn and strong the hearts of the Egyptians. They should go into the sea after them. I will gain honor over Pharaoh and all his hosts and chariots and horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know and realize that I am the Lord." Hallelujah. when I have gained honor and glory over Pharaoh and his chariots and his horsemen. God wants to show himself mighty, whose heart is dedicated to him. That's what God wants to do. And tonight, as we lift up Jesus Christ, as we lift up the circumstances and situations that we are at this point, Lord is saying, go forward. We're not here to back up. We're here to go forward and praise God. When we look at Deuteronomy, we're supposed to love the Lord God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind. And that's even in difficult times. That's even in things when they don't work the way we think they ought to work. Do we serve a big God or don't we serve a big God? Our God is bigger than anything. You know, we got to always let God be bigger than our circumstances. Sometimes we think our circumstance is so big. Well, how am I going to get out of this? How am I going to get out of this? Well, let me tell you, if God delivered you an A, and I say this a lot, if God delivered you over here in A, what makes you possibly think he won't deliver you over here in B? It's the same God. And that's what we always got to be thinking. The same Jesus. He said yesterday, today, and forever. When we look at him, the same Jesus, that same one that healed back then, he's healing now. Yeah. The same God that delivered back then, he's delivering now. Mm-hmm. The same God that gave power back here, he's giving power right now. God wants us to say, soul say yes. Soul say yes. That's what it's about. It's about surrendering to the Lord and saying, you know, yes, Lord. What would you have me to do? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And tonight, as we go into prayer, let us realize that how big God is. We got those seas before us and the gifts behind us, but God says, go forward. Hallelujah. Yeah. Right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we're going to open this up for prayer requests. We're going to remember Sally. You know, definitely remember Sally. Yes.
I just got a message from Tammy.
Yes.
Everything went great.
Good.
She's on her way home.
Good. Hallelujah. 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 That's how God works. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, that's awesome. We were just talking about it, and the call came through on her way home. That's awesome. You know, that's how God works. I know, as I get older in the Lord, I just love the Lord more and more. You know, I remember this older lady. We was up at a revival. And it was a fairly young pastor. I mean, according to her, she was an older lady. And the pastor was probably in his 40s, mm-hmm. Late 40s, you know. And she was sitting by me. And, you know, he was talking. He was doing good. And she just kind of shook her head. She said, he's got a lot to learn. I've been living for the Lord a lot of years. He's got a lot more to learn. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, I didn't take it as a criticism. I take it as a fact. She had walked with the Lord for years and years and years. And the more you walk with him, the more you love him. The more you remember. You know, people in the Old Testament, they would put landmarks. You know, they would raise up stones to work. This is what happened. I remember what happened this day. And I think we ought to do that in our lives. We ought to never forget what God done for us. Never forget that. Make a landmark. I remember I drove a truck through a city up in Minnesota, and they have a high water mark in the middle of town where at one time the flood came through, and they say the high water mark of this year. So they're not forgetting that one year this was flooded. Now it was nice and vegetation and everything, but they remember. And it's good for us to remember. You know what? God got me through this. I just feel that's on my heart. God got me through this point. And you know what? He's going to get me through the next one. And the next one, and the next one. You were born for a reason. To, you know, God's going to give you a future and a hope. He has us here. You ever always, I know I say that a lot when I'm up here, but you ever think why you were born in this generation?
Come on.
You ever think that? You know, you ever think you meet the people who you meet, or you with the person that you're with? You know, I was thinking about that the other night. I said, well, God knows how to knit people together. He knows how to get people together. One thing I always like in the Bible, when they talk about God created a, you know, help me, one of the translations translated out as teammate. You know, it translated teammate. I said, that's good. We're on the same team, right? And that's what we always should be. As Christians, too, we're on the same team. We serve. There's only one God. There's only one God, the Lord God Jesus Christ. There's only one. And when we're on the same team and we worship, man, what if we come together? That's what the Bible said. If my people, that's not talking about the worldly people, that's my people, God's people, will humble themselves and pray and seek his face. Yeah. What could God do then? Hallelujah. Someone else. Someone else. Yes.
Sorry, keep saying that.
That's all right.
She needed to lift it up. She just kind of roller coasters. And a couple days ago, she was doing a lot better. And yesterday, started back in and was coughing and stuff. And right now, she's at home, just kind of weak right now. And she's watching. I know she's watching. So just keep her lifted up and praying and believing for the healing for her lungs.
Yep. We'll definitely do that. We'll definitely do that and pray and continue to pray. And we'll keep remembering Myron, too.
Yes, yes.
And keep remembering our brother, because it's got to be hard not, you know, coming to church. I know I had a surgery, and one time wasn't able to go to church. That was so hard.
Mm-hmm.
That was so hard. And a church family, after church service, they would come over and see me and tell me what went on at the church, you know, and it was just so hard. They wouldn't let me. The only place I could go was basically to the doctor, the grocery store, and back home. I mean, that was it. I couldn't drive. I couldn't go. They just kind of had me at home because I was on so much medication at the time. Mm-hmm. But boy, my heart just, when I was able to go back to church, you know, and mm-hmm. I just was so happy to get in the house of the Lord and to spend that time with God's people, because that's why testimonies are so important.
Yes.
Because your testimony, somebody may be dealing with that same issue.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody might have a question. You think God can do that for me? Well, God's not a respecter of persons. And that's why it's important. You know, we used to have testimony service at a church I was at, and we call them popcorn testimony. Because the pastor, you know, we want one person to pop up. Because the thing is, there was this lady, her name was Bertha. I never forget. She was the sweetest lady. We rode a church bus. And she would always say hi to you. She was so quiet on the church bus. She just would say hi, but she always wore kind of business suit. She was so refined, and she was a very pretty lady, shoulder lady, but she wouldn't say hardly anything other than hi. But buddy, when she got in the church house, and when it came to testimony service, it's like somebody poked her. That's what we was always joking. We was little. It's like somebody poked her, because she would pop up. It was like she'd come out of a toaster. She'd pop up, you know, and she sang the same song. She sang the same song, standing on that rock. You know, she liked to sing that song, standing on that rock. She liked to sing a song of how good God is. She would be fired up because she knew how good. And I always thought about her life, but I'm telling you, when a person has that buried deep inside of them, it is like fire shut up in your bones. You have to say something. One time, I had an individual one time, and he was saying that we got to talking about the subject of Jesus Christ, and he's talking about his grandma, and he said, you know, the problem with my grandma, Tim, is she believes God too much. Buddy, I couldn't let that go. Buddy, I couldn't walk away from that. I said, how can you believe God too much? What are you talking about, man? I believe God, you know, to think about it, think about what God has done for you. I tell you what. If it wasn't for God, we wouldn't be here. You know? I mean, tell you, the breath in our body, all the blessings that we have.
Yes.
You know, we think something's come a long way, let me tell you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I share this. I remember being on, you know, Facebook, and some people get paid on Friday. So Thursday night's pretty slim.
Woo!
Slim pickings.
Yeah, yeah.
So they had Facebook, and they showed a meal. They took a picture of it, and they had like a dressing, turkey dressing or chicken dressing, but they didn't have a drumstick, so they drew a picture of a drumstick.
Yep.
Drew a picture, put it on the plate. And I remember looking at that and said, I remember that. I remember going in, all you had, open that refrigerator. I remember those days, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I remember now you can go and there's food in there. You can go from paycheck to paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
You can drive a better vehicle. You can do those things. Why? Because to give glory to God. That's what we all, I'm telling you, that's what always seemed the cry of God's heart. It's just like when Jesus was walking with us on the earth, you can just tell the way he talked. It's like, I wish the people would just believe me. It was almost a cry of his heart. That's why when he found somebody had faith, he was like, wow, I got somebody that believes. You know, I mean, Jesus, it's so fast. He come all the way from heaven, and he come out as a baby, and he's walking among men. You know, Emmanuel, God with us.
Yes.
Man, I mean, how much, and God's walking with us. You know, when they said, we found a Messiah, this is the one we've been talking about. You know, it's just like, you'd want to spend all your time with it. Martha and Mary got that. Mary got it. Martha was busy around, and Mary just wanted to be at his feet. She understood that. And And the more time we spend with Jesus, the better off we are. Wouldn't you love to do that and paddle around with Jesus?
Come on.
And just be with him and say, thank you, thank you, thank you for all that you've done.
Yes.
You know, just follow him through it all. You know, when you look at Mary Magdalene and they went to the cross, you know, they followed, went to the grave, and they just wanted to be with him. And tonight, just think about that. Be with Jesus.
Amen.
Spend time with Jesus. Somebody else. Someone else. Well, that's awesome, James, and you know, I love teams that flow together. You know, Phil Jackson, I love studying quotes. That's just something I do in the spare time. But you know, that's what he said about winning championships. You got to go from a me to a we, then you can win championships. You can have the greatest star in your basketball team, but if you just got one, it's not gonna work. He can't do it all. You need to get people around him that compliment him, and that's what the church is. You know, you've got some ladies. I was just thinking about a lady when I went to Kingsway years ago, and her only thing she did was pray. And I needed a job, and they said, well, you go find this lady, and she will pray for you.
Uh-huh.
And I remember seeking her out, and she was probably, at that time, probably 80 years old.
Woo.
And she had the biggest blue eyes, just these huge blue eyes. And she stood up so tall, and she'd always call you son. You know, older people do that all the time. You know, you come up, you're their son. Said, son, what can I do for you? I says, man, I heard that you'll pray, and I need to get a job to provide for my family. You know, and she just kind of looked at me and said, let's pray right now. And I mean, she grabbed my hand, you know, like this, and I mean, she had a grip. I mean, boy, I thought she was going to break up my hand, fingers. But she grabbed it, and I mean, you could tell she was reaching heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, bless this young man with a job. Bless him right now. She didn't care what other people thought. She was loud. Right now. Right now.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Man, we got somebody to get a hold of God. Whew. It went above the ceiling in that church all the way up the throne room.
Come on.
And God bless her. That was back in the 80s, and I haven't stopped working since.
Woo.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
I mean, that prayer was answered quick. But I thank you, Lord. And that was the only thing she did in the church. And that's why it's so important to have her. And I thank her for it. I appreciated her getting along with God, you know, away from the church, and God just using it as a conduit, just flowing right through there. And that's what God does, man. If you open your heart to God, what could God do in your life? What could he do in your life? That's what question is good to ask God. You know, what God, what can you do in my life if I surrender to you? Hallelujah. Someone else? Okay. All right. Well, let's go ahead and stand up for prayer, please. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus, that we can come and pray tonight and believe you. That's what it's about. We serve a mighty God. We serve a God that's more than able to answer our prayers, who's able to deliver us whatever we may need, able to bless us. Lord, we thank you for Sally, Lord, on her way home already. We thank you for her getting through that surgery and just totally restore her and make her better than she was before. Lord, also ask you to be with Cindy and touch her. Lord, I know she has a desire to to come to church and be with God's people, but she has these things going on health-wise. But Lord, you are the God that healeth, and we're going to claim that. Same way with Myron. Lord, that you would just touch Myron right now, Lord, and allow him to come to the house of God. Lord, we ask you to be with James' needs too, and Lord, just touch his life. Lord, we thank you for this church. Lord, we thank you for the fact that, Lord, you have a great family right here. We got godly members that want to love you and that want to yield totally to you. Give their whole life, Lord. Lord, let them leave tonight, Lord, not the same way that they came. Lord, just we ask you to bless this church. We ask you to just to fill it up. We ask you, to Lord, to meet every need that maybe it was unspoken tonight. But God, one thing about it, we serve a wonderful God. We serve a mighty Savior, a mighty Creator. Hallelujah. A wonderful Counselor that hears our every request, that hears it, and we can go boldly to the throne. Hallelujah. That our prayers are going to go above the ceiling and all the way up to you, Lord, and we're going to thank you ahead of time for the answers. We're going to thank you, Lord, for those prayer requests. We may have been praying 10 years, 20 years to see somebody come to know you. Maybe it's a child or a grandchild or our brother or sister or our children. Maybe somebody, some need that people have been praying for. Answer it tonight. And Lord, those areas in our life that you are telling us tonight to go forward on, let us not be afraid of the Egyptians in the back. Hallelujah. Let us not be fearful of the Red Sea in front. Let us go forward. Hallelujah. Because you are going to show the way. Hallelujah. You can split the Red Sea and allow us to go on dry land. Because, Lord, we know it's all about you. There's no problem too big. Which way should I go? Which way should I go? You made it plain. You are the way. We need to follow you. We need to live for you. You died for us. Surely we can live for you. And Father God, as we go into the song service, Lord, that, Lord, you let our hearts, be full of you. Let us worship your holy name. Because without you, where would we be? We remember those slim times. Paul said he learned to be content, whether he had a lot or whether he had a little, because he realized it all came from you. And Father God, as we praise you and as the preaching will come a little bit, Lord, let that word come and change us. Because that's what it's about. We are ambassadors for your sake. And Lord, we ask you as we look at this country, that Lord, a lot of division, but Lord, we know that we need to come together in unity. Behold how good it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And Lord, I know there's a lot of emotion here, but Lord, it's a time for those that believe to seek you, to fall on their face before you, and realize that God's the one that can change hearts. God's the one that can change lives. God's the one that can give that vision. Just like Elisha had the servant open her eyes and seen that was more that was with us than with them. And Lord, let us never forget what you've done for us. And we want to praise you in your wonderful holy name. We pray, amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
If you have a cell phone, we ask you to put it on vibrate or turn it off, please. Eastern Gate House of Prayer, that's this Friday, 11 o'clock,
and you're already
or November 11th,
you bet you.
7 o'clock.
You bet. You've already touched on it. We're going to be praying for unity, restoration in this country, letting the left hand know what the right hand's doing, just with God's left hand and God's right hand, just to bind us together in his love. And I didn't get to post it yet, but the Lord gave me a word this morning that I haven't posted yet. I was going to put it on Facebook. In fact, I think it was in response to something Sarah put on there. Glad to see you guys. Glad you made it back. Got wheels now? Glory.
One.
gone through a revolution, it seemed like, in the last 24 hours, a revolution in the unseen realm. But he says, this is not what I'm ultimately after. What I'm ultimately after is a reformation and revival in this nation. He wants this nation changed, its heart changed in this nation. And we've seen evidence of it today, you know, the protests and the walking out of schools that I've never even heard such a thing like that. But there's a unity, a peace, and a calmness that needs to come through the body of Christ to show the Lord's love of what he wants to really show in this land. Uh-huh. And the next revival, we understand, will be the revival of love, the grace, and the mercy. Uh-huh. So anyway, that's kind of what I'm supposed to be posting. I haven't done it yet. Anyway.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And we have a soup dinner November 20th after service. So join us. Do have a sign-up sheet there by the double doors there. And let's go ahead and speak the word, please.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you?
Glory.
Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Eric, would you come, please, and take the offering for us tonight? Thank you. The rest can be seated. Thank you.
Father God, thank you so much for all the blessings you bestow upon us, the blessing to live in this country. Is, you know, so many in the world face so much. We are so blessed to be here. We do thank you for that.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, that you are all seeing, and you know the hearts of man. You know what it takes to stir people. You know what people need. And so in this time when so many are so unsettled about things, really, they're so uninformed on, they're so scared of, that you know the truth, and I just want to proclaim right now, it's a time of reprieve from the judgment that was coming on America, because
yes.
I know it was, Lord, and you've told me that,
mm-hmm.
and I thank you for that, and I know that you've also told me that, thank you, it's now is the time for us to walk forward in truth boldly.
There it is.
Because you've given it to us, Father,
yes.
And we're just, I'm claiming that right now.
Yes.
I'm claiming that for anybody who wants it.
Yes.
It's here. If you want it,
yes.
take it.
Yes.
Because, Lord, we were being lined up like sheep for the fleecing.
Yep.
And you know, I just thank you so much that we have a time of reprieve. Let us go and let us become,
yes.
your hands. Let us become your feet. Let,
yes.
us go forward in boldness and proclaim,
yes.
your love for people.
Yes,
let us be,
is.
Living epistles. Because that's, you know, it's a time where we need to do this.
Mm-hmm.
We have time and we need to move forward boldly and quickly. Thank you so much for,
yes.
that. Thank you that everything's already been done in Jesus, and that's just so amazing.
Hallelujah.
It's been done. Healing's,
yes.
been proclaimed.
Yes.
So the issue's not with you. The issue's with us aligning with you,
yes.
and believing your word, because it's already,
mm-hmm.
been done.
Yes.
Financially, physically, everything's been done. Lord, has help us see that. Help us understand,
yes,
that. Help us move past the things that hold us back, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Help us move past the dead works that try to stop us,
mm-hmm.
try to divert our eyes from the real truth that's you, and help us all in this country to understand,
yes.
that first of all, we're Christians. First of all, we're yours. We're your children.
Yes,
that we've,
Lord.
Been bought by Christ. So it doesn't matter who gets in the White House, because our mission's the same. It doesn't change.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, whether it's easier for us, whether it's harder for us, you know, we just do the same thing every day.
Yes.
So help us wake up and realize who we are every day.
Yes.
That we're Christians first, you know, and family, you know, second, Americans third.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you so much for that, Father. Thank you.
Yes.
You've already blessed us financially. We come here and we just gladly give you our offerings and thank you that you've already returned them to us, Lord. We just thank you for blessing us, taking care of us, and we just look to your hand in everything we do. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Brother Tim.
Bless you.
It's
bless
always
you.
A pleasure.
Bless you.
There's a lot of tired people out there right now. Hallelujah. But he said, come unto me, all you who are labored and are heavy and laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle, lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. turning and rest. You shall be saved. And quietness and confidence shall be your strength.
Looking for
Lord,
Father, we love you tonight. We thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you tonight. We thank you that the election is over. But we have so far yet to go. No matter how it would have turned out, Lord, today would have been a difficult day for half of this nation. Our nation is so divided. And the hate and the anger and the misunderstanding and the fear, Lord. The fear of the unknown, Lord. We need you now more than ever. We believe, Lord, that you have selected and you have chosen and you have anointed our new president. And we ask that your hand be upon him, that you give him wisdom and revelation, Lord, that he would seek your counsel, that he would be a man after your heart, that he would surround himself with wise counselors. We ask you to bless the Vice President, Mike Pence, and our President, Donald Trump, Lord, our President-elect. We ask that the transition would be smooth, Lord, and that the global markets and the global turmoil that has been talked of will just not come to pass, Lord. That this transition will be peaceful, and this nation will begin to heal. Lord, it's hard to love your neighbor when you don't like him sometimes. But loving is not liking. Loving is choosing. Loving is choosing to see them through your eyes. And you have died. You have shed your blood for every single Adam to be born since Adam. And the unborn as well, Lord. Every man is our brother. Every woman is our sister. We are one race, the human race created. That first breath that you breathed into Adam, that first breath is the same breath that is in every single one of us tonight. Republican, Democrat, it doesn't matter. We are your creation. We are descendants of the one true God, formed in your image, chosen to be priests and kings in your kingdom, Lord. Let us act accordingly. Let us be ambassadors of your kingdom, Lord. A kingdom that confounds the ways of the world. A kingdom that confounds the media, that confounds the political establishments. That your kingdom turns this world upside down. Just as you did, Jesus, when you walked this earth. But you did so in love and in mercy. Let us take love and mercy everywhere we go. Let us open our arms to our brothers and sisters, our neighbors. And let us seek peace, Lord. This is an opportunity, Lord. Everything that happens in our life is a choice, an opportunity to either bring forth the truth of your kingdom and reconcile ourselves to you as we reconcile those around us and speak truth in love, or to continue to divide and let the evil one have his way in this nation. I thank you. I thank you, Lord, that the judgment that was facing this nation has been stopped right now. We thank you, Lord. Jesus, be with us tonight, Lord. Be with us as I share your word tonight. Be with us as we leave and as we move throughout this week. And meet us here again on Friday night as we come to worship and seek your face, Lord. In Jesus' name. Feels the burden to pray, but I didn't want to stop praying. There is such an urgent need for prayer, and the Lord's heart is that we seek reconciliation through prayer, because it's going to take prayer for me to keep my heart right when my family wants to throw stones, when the people that I love and care about don't understand and want to throw stones and be hateful. It's going to take a lot of prayer for all of us to focus on Him and let His will be done. altar of remembrance tonight because it was something special last month at Eastern Gate House of Prayer. And I know not everybody was able to come, and not everybody sees what I see or hears what I hear. So I want to share because I think it was really something special. And I know for me it was revelation. So I'm going to start tonight in Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. I think before I can share what happened, I think the Lord wants to make sure that we all know just a reminder of who we are and what we've been called to do. Matthew 10, verse 1. Joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And he said to them, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. Listen carefully. I have given you authority that you now possess to tread on serpents and scorpions and the ability to exercise authority over all the power of the enemy, Satan, and nothing will in any way harm you. He gave them that authority. He gave us as believers authority before he ever ascended, right? In his name. John chapter 14, verse 12. John 14, 12. I like all the different versions, so I have to remember which one I want to use. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Now, I read, and these works look pretty great. Casting out spirits, you know, healing, all the things that happened. He said greater than those things. I don't even see those things happening, you know. And then I want to talk about the prayer that Jesus prayed before he went to the cross. Let's go to John chapter 17, verses 20 through 23. John 17, 20 through 23. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may all be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. I'm going to read that out of the Message Bible, because there's a lot of thous in those, and sometimes I get tripped up in that. But the Message Bible says, I'm praying not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me because of them and their witness about me. The goal is for all of them to become one heart and one mind, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, so that they might be one heart and one mind with us, that the world might believe that you, in fact, sent me. The same glory you gave me, I gave them, so they'll be as unified and together as we are, I in them and you in me. Then they'll mature in this oneness and give the godless world evidence that you've sent me and loved me in the same way that you've loved, that you loved them the same way that you loved me. This evidence of the maturity of this oneness. I think the church is just beginning to grasp the oneness that binds us together, the love, the grace message is finally having its day. The Lord is finally opening our eyes and binding us together and reconciling us to one another. No more days of so-and-so's ministry, right? No more names on the billboards. It's God. It's Jesus, right? It's Jesus. It's his love. It's his grace. I want to understand that oneness. You know, there's a doctrine of oneness, and then there's just being one. And then, as we all know, Jesus died, and he rose again, and he ascended. But that wasn't the end of the story, right?
Right.
Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the world. He sent back his Holy Spirit. So now is he not only upon us, he is in us. The Holy Spirit is in us. Now, you know, I don't know everybody's doctrinal past. I don't know what church doctrine you've studied or not, but I was baptized in a oneness theology church, and I struggled with this, right? Because there's this revelation that you're supposed to attain that makes you somehow smarter than every other Christian. And I was praying, right? And I'm praying, and I'm like, Lord, this seems like semantics to me. Like, you know, I am one person. I have a body. I have a spirit, and I possess a soul. Like, I'm one person. This doesn't seem like this is difficult. But the mystery of a marriage, right? The Bible tells us when we're married, the two become one. Well, you know, I see a couple sitting here that's married. They're still two people. There's a mystery, right, that happens. And then the Lord is one with us, right? We're one with each other, and then there's all this oneness happening. And so it's just always something that I've pondered, right? I'm a very academic person. I'm a little obsessive, my personality, right? So I'm a deep diver. When I want to study something, I'm a deep diver. I obsess, I research it, I deep dive it, I go until I just, my husband's giving me the thumbs up. I obsess, like I can't stop myself, I want to know everything. And now, thank goodness for the internet, because in the old days, it was a kitchen table with I don't even remember all the names of the books, but there was the reference, there was the topical Bible, the reference Bible, the dictionaries, I mean, the Strong's Concordance. I mean, I had books that were heavy, big books that were always on my table, and I was studying this, and it would lead to that, and buddy trail here, and I just couldn't get enough, right? I wanted to know everything. And there's just times when we just, it's not about knowing. It's not about understanding. There's this thing called revelation. And it's in the Lord's time. As much as we want it to be in our time, it's on the Lord's time. And boy, did I try and force some of those things because I was hungry. You know, I just wanted to understand. I wanted to know. But that oneness is all, I understand it conceptually, you know, but I never really, I wouldn't say that I got it. I thought I had pieces of it. You know, I'd had, you know, things happen. But I'd always fascinated by that. And then fast forward from all my years as studying and being anal Christian to Revelation chapter 4. I want to go through Revelation chapter 4 I want to do verses 1 through 11, the whole chapter. Because one of the things I've also obsessed about is heavenly worship, because I'm a worshiper. I love to worship. I love to play my bass. I love to sing. I'm not a singer, but I love to worship with my voice. It's, I don't know, my husband, if it's not anointed, it's not. It's kind of scary, but... My husband has to listen to me learn and practice new songs that are, I gotta practice a lot. But I love to worship. It's a joyful noise to me. I don't do it for you guys. I'm sorry, I don't. I do it for him, and I love it, and it's from my spirit, and so it's beautiful to him. But the heavenly worship, wow, is this an awesome picture of what it's going to be like in heaven, right? To worship with the throne room, the sea of glass, the heavenly Sanhedrin, all the angels, all the four living creatures. I know this chapter. I don't even have to look on the screen, but I'm going to read it to you. But the candlesticks, like the eyes. I mean, I have studied every single aspect of Revelation chapter 4. And I had an experience last month that blew everything that I know about heavenly worship right out the window. Blew it out the window. Because I got revelation. And all of my knowledge is back there in the garbage can right now. And I really want to share with you what happened. So this is what I expected, right? We expect to experience the things that we read in the Bible. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me. Cool, a talking trumpet. I'm down with that, right? Talking trumpet, that would be kind of fun. Which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be the hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit. I don't know if you guys, has anybody else had those experiences where you just know you're in the spirit? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, those are moments, those are God moments, right? Those are those moments where you build an altar, and those are places of remembrance. I've had moments, those visions, whatever you want to call them, imaginations, whatever you want to call them, I've had those from 18 years ago, and I remember them like they were yesterday. Like, those are God moments that are sealed and are sacred. Amen. And immediately I was in the spirit. And you know, you better pay attention when you know you're in the spirit. And behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardius stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, but there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about them, and they were full of eyes within. And they rest not day and night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. That is awesome. That is the coolest imagery. I bought paintings of what people like painted to think that looked like. I have the, you know, paintings or pictures of the 4 living creatures, of the throne, of the sea of glass, the colors, the jewels, the sparkle, the thunder, the lightning. I mean, there's so much overwhelming, like, to the human senses, the color, the sound, the light, the brilliance of the color, I'm sure there were smells. I mean, our senses would just go crazy. And then we were worshiping, and something happened. There was a shift, and I know Mike felt it, I know all of us, and it just changed. And I perceived an invitation for us to ascend and all of us to join in the heavenly worship in the throne room in the sea of glass. And we did. We all ascended, and a song came forth, and I was shocked because I was looking for the 4 living creatures. I was looking for the 24 elders. I was looking for the candles. I was looking for the color. I was looking for the lightning and the thunder. But I'm telling you, there was just Jesus. Mm-hmm. Nothing but Jesus. Everything and Jesus. I don't know how to describe it other than to say everything was present, but everything was one, and it was all Jesus. Everything, all of us were Jesus. We were Jesus singing to Jesus. We were Jesus worshiping Jesus. There was a sound that came forth. I'm sure that there was colors, but there, human senses just don't, they just fail, right? We can't see. Our spirits have eyes, but they don't see like our human body. There was light, but more than that, there was joy unspeakable. Mm-hmm. There was peace that passes understanding. There was a love that soaked through your bones, and you were one with Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I had it wrong, right? I was studying and wanting to understand the four living creatures. I wanted to know what the angels were saying. I wanted to know what this represented, what that means. The symbolism, everything means something, because Jesus told us in his word that if you will read and understand the book of Revelation, you will be blessed. And I'm here to tell you, Nathan had it right. The whole book is nothing but just Jesus. Everything, every symbol, every word, every phrase is just Jesus.
Yes.
And I've heard so many Christians talk about the jewels in their crown. Well, I'm going to get a jewel. I tease my husband and say, oh, I'm getting a jewel in my crown for that. There are no crowns. There's just Jesus.
Right.
We talk about mansions. He goes to prepare a place for us. Our mansions in heaven. There are no mansions. It's just Jesus. And Nathan always jokes about we're going to go up and float in a cloud and play our harp and worship Jesus. There's no harps. There's no musical instruments. There's just Jesus. And it's glorious. It's beautiful. There is a song that never stops. There is worship that never stops.
Right.
But if we're looking for anything in heaven other than Jesus, we're going to be disappointed, because I'm telling you, it's just Jesus. And I'm telling you, that is so much more than enough.
Amen.
There's so much more than enough. Not one moment was I disappointed or confused. At first I was shocked, right? I mean, it was shocking. It wasn't what I expected,
mm-hmm.
but it was wonderful. There was no confusion in the worship. There was no confusion. You know, there was, it just was. And I think that my shock was what I felt as my information was replaced with revelation.
Yes.
And that's what the Lord wants to do for all of us. He wants to replace our information with revelation. He wants us to know that we know that we know. I know that the four living creatures were there. I know they were there. I didn't see them. I didn't need to see them, because they're Jesus. I could hear the voices. I couldn't see them. I didn't need to see them, because they're Jesus. We are one. I finally understood what it meant. There was no me. There was no us. There was only Jesus. But we were all together. We were all together. We were one. But it was just Jesus. I don't know how else to say it. It was just Jesus. And it was glorious.
Amen.
And I'm telling you that this world, this nation, needs one thing. Just Jesus.
Amen.
We need just one thing. Just Jesus. Because when we allow ourselves to let go of our own identity, right? I let go of my voice. I let go of my knowledge. I think I was playing bass. I don't even know. I don't think I was. I don't know if I was playing bass or not. I just let go.
Amen.
And suddenly, it was just Jesus. That changes things. It changed me forever. And I think it changed this atmosphere. I think it changed this realm. I think it does things. When those unseen battles, there is a principality. I don't know everybody. I don't want to get too out there, but there's a principality and a power over this city that has had this city for a very long time.
Right.
And it does not want to let go.
Right.
But we have been given authority in the name of Jesus. He gave us authority before he ever died and rose again and placed his own spirit within us. Even if we didn't have the Holy Spirit, we still have the authority over these principalities and powers. But not only do we have that authority as just the Son of God, We are now Jesus. There's no beginning and no end. I am Jesus as I stand before you here today.
Thank you, Lord.
That's blasphemous in many churches. But there is no end and no beginning. We are one. And only when I can let go and allow others to see only just Jesus in me, then it's still going to be division. It's still going to be confusion. It's still going to be chaos. The Lord wants to mend our hearts, our brothers and sisters' hearts, this nation. The Lord wants to restore the things that have been broken. The Lord wants good. Our Father gives good gifts. But we have to ask for the right things, right? And so that's my message tonight. It's just Jesus. And that's more than enough.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen.